Hey, Foot Clan, the time you have been waiting for is here. The Wheel of Water app is out, so make your bets with your friends and put your water where your mouth is.
Curse splash!
Fantasy Footballers Podcast with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
It is the little things, my friend. It is the little things. And the joy of watering your friends, that's what makes fantasy football fun.
I'm extremely excited for when the videos start coming in.
Yes, use the hashtag WheelOfWater on Twitter if you film any of these waterings. These payouts, and we will we'll retweet them
absolutely
with great joy. So yeah, that's pretty funny. We're excited. We had a lot of people download the Wheel of Water app yesterday, so that was very fun. Shout out to our developers at Polygon Sushi.
Yo
for developing that fun app, and so we'll keep and just so the world knows, so I don't have like 4,000 more.
What's a water bet?
No, okay, we'll go through that too. But I was gonna say. It'll come to Android, okay? We're going to get it on Android, too. We haven't ignored you. It's just, we're getting all the bugs out and getting it out on iOS, and we'll keep going. So welcome to the show. This is the Fantasy Footballers Podcast, and it is Friday, November 6th. We are going to go ahead and we're going to cover the second half of the games for Week 9. We've got our injury updates for you. We've got our Daily Dose segment today with Chris Meaney of the Fantasy Sports Network, getting you everything you need to know for FanDuel. And, that's always some beautiful FanDuel DFS nuggets on that segment. We got our mailbag today. We're going to answer some listener questions. And don't forget to check us out on Twitter at the FF Ballers. You can visit our website, thefantasyfootballers.com. And if you do want to grab that app, go to wheelofwater.com, or you can grab it on the website. Pretty easy to do that.
It's everywhere.
It is. You guys watched the game last night?
No. What? There was a game?
Yeah, football. NFL.
I did. I very much enjoyed
a Johnny football. A Johnny football game.
Yeah. Was he? He was there? The Bengals looked amazing. They looked, how they've looked for a lot of the season, but I'm starting to believe that they might be able to do it in the first round of the playoffs.
Well, the AFC landscape has changed a little bit. You know, I wouldn't expect, even if the Colts get out of the AFC South, which... seems really easy to do right now. Cleveland might be leading that division if they were in that division. They're not the powerhouse that we expected. There's kind of, the Jets. The Jets are good, but they've had games off, and, there's New England. But you're not going to play New England in the first round if you win your division. So, I don't know. Cincinnati's looking pretty good, like you said. They definitely did what good teams do, which is come out in the second half and dominate. 17 unanswered points in the second half. And Johnny Manziel looked okay.
Yeah, he looked
okay.
Okay.
I mean, against the defense that was playing well, and he had a lot of guys drop passes. And if you had Gary Barnage, you were disappointed last night.
Called it. Sorry, wow. I've been calling it for like 4 weeks. I finally got the Barnage. Cold water.
That was ridiculous.
So I had.
Hey,
to
we
say
talked
it.
About it on the show. We said Barnage might struggle with the quarterback change. I think McCown will be back next week.
I agree. So do not panic on Barnage.
No. And there were a lot of people deciding, oh, Barnage or Gates or Barnage or Reed and things like that. But So we'll...
And the answer was, of course, Tyler Eifert.
Right. Yes. The answer to all questions was Tyler Eifert, who I was just saying before the show almost had four. He almost had four touchdowns. Mike, how are you doing with the whole Jeremy Hill situation?
I was on full tilt last night. I don't know if you were following my Twitter feed.
Oh, yeah, I saw that you were in a spiral of depression.
So I will start with this. This has nothing to do with Giovanni Bernard. Gio looks fantastic.
Yep.
I'm not taking anything away from Gio. It's just frustrating to me to watch Jeremy Hill, and I agree that something looks wrong. Like, he's...
There's some hesitation to the way he runs right
he's,
now.
He's stutter stepping almost all the time instead of just hitting the hole like Gio is doing. They showed that stat yesterday on the game of how many yards is he running before he gets 1 yard, and it's basically 5 yards or something.
Ouch.
Like that. It's this really weird stat that I've not come across before, and Gio was very productive in this particular statistic. But when you see him, what it felt like to me. is whenever they would put him in a power formation with a fullback, then he would go. And that's when he would rip off the 6 yards. But then they would do that once, and then they'd go to the shotgun and try and pull these trickery runs, which that's not what he does. He's a power back. Just let him run
You're saying where he has no head of steam. He's taking the ball in the shotgun handoff.
I agree.
I saw that too.
So they should leave Gio in the game. I agree.
Well, no, I mean, you can't overrun Gio either. You can't give Gio 27 carries and expect him to stay healthy. He's a little guy. He's clearly done what Mike has said in the past, which is be extremely effective when he's not the workhorse. They're going to need Jeremy Hill.
Yes.
But, okay, so audible here. Quick question of the day before we get into the news and notes and the injury segment. Moving forward, you're a team with Jeremy Hill. He's an RB.
Low-end RB2.
Okay, so that has to concern you a little bit as
an
owner.
It just concerns you from where you drafted him. But, I mean, we're way past the draft of the value of a guy where you took him in the draft. You just have to adjust your expectations. The problem was, this was the ultimate matchup for a Jeremy Hill-type game.
Leading the game.
They're up big. The Cleveland Browns are the worst rushing defense in the league, and you expected to see 20 Jeremy Hill carries. But you would see entire series. There was at least twice, two drives, where it was Gio Bernard.
Yep.
The entire drive.
That's probably when you were pacing your house, stomping your feet.
Oh, man. It was
spitting your food out.
It was
whatever
not
you do
good
when you're on tilt.
And I had tweeted, all I wanted to see was what happens with the team when they line up two consecutive power formations with Jeremy Hill and give him the ball. What would happen? That's all I wanted to see. And I just. It never happened.
To be continued.
Yeah. So, but for my fellow Hill truthers who are on full tilt, you can't overreact of saying, well, I'm never playing him again. He still had over 50 yards. He's giving you low end running back 2 numbers, and he always has the chance to put up touchdowns. I mean,
sure.
Eifert happened to be the guy who caught all the touchdowns. There was four scoring opportunities. And so that's that. You still have to play the probabilities of it's a good chance that Hill gets one of them.
Yep.
Or if not multiples of them, it just didn't work out in this particular game.
Yep. All right, let's go ahead and get you into the news and notes.
News and notes from around the league.
All righty, let's go ahead and shoot through these. This is some stuff that you got to know, starting with Gary Kubiak officially naming Ronnie Hillman the starter, but views both of them as ones. This is kind of what we said yesterday. We think carries will still be split. Hillman is the official starter now. I'm more confident starting Hillman than Anderson. Do you guys agree?
Probably. This is almost a mirror image of the Bengals, of Hillman and Anderson. For
yeah.
Gio and
no, you're right.
Or I mean Hillman and Anderson and Gio
but a,
and Hill.
But a tier down in terms of production.
Yes, absolutely.
T.Y. Hilton is still wearing a walking boot. The report this morning said he will be a game time decision.
Ugh.
Everybody wants a game time decision against the Broncos, right?
Yeah. Sit him down.
Sit him. This is a blessing. It might honestly be
Andre. No, nobody. Nobody Andre Johnson.
Is that the Andre Johnson chant?
Andre
it's more like, Andre, Andre. All right. Ryan Matthews didn't practice on Thursday.
That's gross.
He's been missing practice and playing.
Weren't they on a bye week?
That's true.
That's gross.
And remember, he hurt his groin a couple plays before that big long play last game. So if this is still lingering, I agree it is gross. But it looks good for DeMarco Murray, my unbelievable start of the week.
All right, let me see if there's some news here that's not injury-related. Otherwise, we'll go through our in and out segment here.
Titans,
yeah. Coach Mike Mularkey has emphasized the running game in practice this week, and we are super excited.
Well, Antonio Andrews is worth making sure he's on your roster. If he's on the waivers, he should be taken and put on your bench because there is always the chance with a new head coach and a focus on that game. If he's just made the bell cow, which I don't expect fully to happen, maybe he's productive.
And ESPN reporters are saying that it wouldn't be a surprise if Jeremy Langford got.
It would be a surprise.
If he did not get 20. Yeah, yeah. So he's my start of the week this week. We like Jeremy Langford a lot. The opportunity, the defense he's playing Monday night, roll him out there. I'd roll him out there over most guys. He's my number 6 this week, which I know might sound crazy.
Yeah,
but.
No, he is an RB1 this week, and we have so many questions coming in of, like, they're not even considering Langford. They're like, which guys? Oh, I've also got this guy on my bench. It's like,
so let's go ahead and get into the injury report.
What's it gonna be, McFly? Are you in or out?
All right, in or out, Marcus Mariota.
In.
All right, Deion Lewis.
In.
Ryan Matthews, we just talked about him. Do you think he's going to play?
Yes, scary. I think he's going to play.
Orleans Dark was back. Is he playing?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. He's the fourth.
If you want, that's more news to me for people who are Rashad Jennings and Vereen owners.
Yeah.
Of Dark would just ruining everybody's day.
We have a lot of wide receivers that were kind of questionable this week in your leagues. So Brandon Marshall, do you think he's out there?
Yes.
I think he'll be in.
Martavis Bryant?
Yeah, in. he was sick and missed a practice, but he's back, so in.
What about Willie Snead?
Returned to limited practice on Thursday, so I'm going to say in.
Agreed.
Emmanuel Sanders?
In.
In.
What about Eric Decker missing practice?
Always in. Eric Decker, for me, if he's not at the hospital on Sunday, he will play.
And probably score a touchdown.
Yeah.
Sammy Watkins?
I think he plays, but right. I'm not like throwing him back in my lineup immediately. I'm not counting on him.
We just talked about it. T.Y. Hilton?
I would say out. Yeah.
Kendall Wright?
Ruled out. This
he's been
official.
Ruled out. That's right. Reuben Randle?
In.
Here's the thing about Reuben Randle, real quick. He's a wide receiver 4.
Yeah.
He's just not getting it done. I'd rather have Dwayne Harris all day long.
I think
I
a big part
Reuben
of that
Randle.
Is this injury.
Yeah.
It's and been his, lingering for
and
know, a month.
Most of his career. Vincent Jackson. Vincent
out.
Jackson.
I think he's going to be out.
Okay. I agree. And so we like Mike Evans.
Yeah.
You know, he's a lot like the Allen Robinson type where you have to play him if you want those big boom weeks. So hopefully he's not your number one.
I love him.
Yeah. No. I like him, but I liked him last week, and you just never know.
And then tight ends, Austin Seferian Jenkins.
Ooh,
is he going to play?
He's been limited all week.
I think he's going to be out.
He's going to be out, too.
Ladarius Green in a, what, protective boot?
Yeah, I think he's out.
And then Larry Donnell.
He had the neck injury last week. I think he might be out.
Yeah, I think all three of those guys are going to sit.
You know, that sounded like a more pretty nice report. More guys playing than not.
So long as you're not a tight end.
Yeah, that's true.
So before we get to the second half of the fantasy forecast, we want to take a second to thank our sponsor, FanDuel. You've heard us talk about FanDuel. It's FanDuel.com. They are the leader in 1 week fantasy football. The money is real. They are expecting to pay out $2 billion this year. Building a team is easy. Just pick your players, stay under the salary cap, sit back on Sunday, watch your team win. Entry fees start at just $1. Anyone can play. Think you know football? Come prove it. FanDuel.com. Last week, Scott from Dallas won $250,000. Fellas, $250,000. Playing fantasy football.
That was me.
That is you're
no, it wasn't
it's
me.
A lot of cash.
That's living the dream. So it's never too late to join. Come play every week this season over at FanDuel.com. And this is what we need the Foot Clan to do. You've been sitting on the edge. You haven't signed up yet. Go to FanDuel.com. You click on the microphone in the upper right-hand corner. You use our code BALLERS.
Ballers.
Yeah, thanks, guys.
Hey, we got it together. Unison.
And this is what they do. It's a special offer for new users. You use our code BALLERS. For every dollar you deposit, FanDuel will match it with up to $200 for free.
I love it.
As you play, FanDuel.com, where it can finally pay to be a fan. That's FANDUEL.com. Sign up today. Promo code BALLERS.
BALLERS. And I want to thank our other sponsor of today's show. You know him. It's MeUndies. Listen, guys, you don't ignore.
And gals.
Yeah, guys and gals. You don't ignore your fantasy team, and you don't ignore your underpants. Okay?
This is
the
truth.
You don't ignore. Listen, Jason, you know that feeling more than all people of putting on old saggy underwear, don't you?
I don't this morning, Andy.
Why is that?
Because I'm wearing MeUndies.
Oh, MeUndies is the most comfortable underwear you will ever wear. And it's insane how good they make you feel.
It's true. Look how happy I am.
They fit perfectly. They don't ride up on you. They literally pull moisture away from your skin so that you stay cool. And I've got mine on right now as well. And I am floating. I'm floating.
Sitting on a cloud.
Sitting on a cloud. The materials they use are sustainably sourced from the Austrian Alps. They're completely natural. They are more than 2 times softer than cotton. And I can tell you that's true.
Your butt cheeks can attest
they
to
can
that?
They can testify. So listen. Here, I'll make it easy. Go to MeUndies.com/footballers. And people ask, where do you go? This is where you go. MeUndies.com/footballers. You get 20% off your free order. with free shipping.
First order.
Did I say free order?
You did.
Yes.
Yeah, it's not completely free. You get 20% off your first order with free shipping, and you save even more when you buy a pack of them, and then you too can be floating like I am. So they guarantee you're going to be happy. Check them out, MeUndies.com/footballers. Thanks for supporting the show, MeUndies. Let's go ahead and get into the fantasy forecast.
Fantasy forecast.
Every time we have the MeUndies spot and we talk about the Austrian Alps so badly, I just want to throw out the, oh, good day, mates. Full Dumb and Dumber. No?
Yeah. I got it.
All right.
All right. All right. Let's go. Fine. Titans at Saints. Does the beat go on for Drew Brees? That's the question everyone wants to know.
I think it does.
Yeah, but you've got to temper expectations, obviously. I mean,
you mean not seven touchdowns?
Not seven touchdowns.
Oh, man.
He's been throwing mostly ones and a couple of twos this year. So now where do you put the over-under on his touchdowns this game against a beatable defense in Tennessee? They're middle of the pack. They're not the worst against the pass, but they're definitely beatable.
Well, they... You know, the Titans stink against the run. So I think Ingram has a big game. I think you're looking two touchdowns probably for Brees, 2 to 3.
Yeah, I would put the over-under at 2.5.
Yeah.
All right, 2.5. So you take the under, Andy?
No, I'd take the over.
You take the over, so you're going 3?
I'd go 3.
I think we're going to get the old 3x3.
Yeah, I do too.
Yeah, so good game to start. Drew Brees, do you start him over Cam Newton?
Yeah. Yes.
You start him over Matt Castle? No, I'm just so we think Mariota's playing. What is the impact of Mariota playing but right out?
That's brutal. I think you have to give the big boost to Walker. Delanie, yep. Walker. I like him.
Start of the week.
Yeah, it's good. I like him a lot this week. And let's see what we can get out of Doriel Green Beckham this week. Can we finally get some targets over to his direction? I think the fantasy community really would like to see what he could do. Given an opportunity.
I completely agree. Tell me a couple things here. One, tell me how you would rank the Saints wide receivers in terms of starting them.
I would definitely rank them Cooks, then Snead, then Colston.
Okay.
And I would go Snead, Cooks, Colston.
Yeah, but monitor Snead.
Yeah, oh yeah, of course. With the health, yes.
And then lastly, with Kyrie Robinson out, C.J. Spiller had a somewhat productive week last week, especially in PPR formats. Would you flex him out?
Yeah. I think C.J. Spiller is a flexible option. He can touch his toes. but he is able to go.
Is he more flexible than Chris Thompson?
I don't know.
Chris Thompson can only get to his ankles. So
I was
yes.
genuinely hearing that question.
Yeah, you were.
As in, what are his muscles like?
I've seen him do yoga. His Warrior 3 is just pitiful.
I would rather
yoga, dude. Yoga is just called. You know what yoga's called for me? Tall guy falling down. That's my best yoga move. Is tall guy awkward bird falling down. That's all I.
I like it. I would go Spiller over Chris Thompson.
Yes.
I don't mind Thompson this week.
And Ingram, man, I think Ingram is just going to start eating the rest of the season. No Robinson to snatch away touchdowns. I think they all go to Ingram. And of course, Spiller can get him from distance, but up close is Ingram now.
Let me recommend something to fantasy players now that the situation's a little more clear in New Orleans. You want C.J. Spiller on your team if you're an Ingram owner. Ingram does have a history with some injury issues. If he's getting a larger workload now, you never know what's going to happen. You're coming into the playoffs, and Spiller would be a guy that could step into that role if he had to, okay? They don't want him to be the between the tackle all the time, but he could do it. And so you kind of want that handcuff if he's available in your league. So that'd be my advice to you. The Saints are favored pretty heavily in this game, so it'll be a good one to see. But in New Orleans, they play well, and I expect a lot of fantasy points from that side of the ball. The Raiders go into Pittsburgh.
Well, so how do you guys feel about Mariota, knowing that the Saints are kind of near the bottom of passing defense?
He has the chance, I think, to put up a big game, but there's
Kendall
so
Wright
many,
is crucial.
Yeah, there's so many other guys that I think have a higher floor. I would not be shocked if Mariota has a great game, but I don't want to chase after that just because of this defense.
Okay.
Yeah. No, that's a good point. We didn't speak to him flex wise or stream wise. I mean, Raiders go in to play Pittsburgh. Very high scoring game. Really don't know what to expect, to be honest with you, because Steelers defense on one hand has been very good. They played great last week, even though they lost to Cincinnati. But the Raiders have been flying high. And we had our jointhefoot.com, you know, the Foot Clan mailbag show yesterday.
Oh, man.
And I think about eight times we sent in the Carr when the question came up. So we like, do we like Carr?
Yes, yeah. We like Carr.
Do we like, do you like him more than Big Ben, though?
No.
No, because of just, you know, Pittsburgh's at home, the weapons. We like Big Ben, but he looked slow last week.
Yeah, he looked very hobbled and rusty. I mean, some of those throws were just bad, especially the final throw of the game where they could have I can't remember if it was a tie or take the lead, but he overthrew Brown by a couple yards out of the end zone. I mean, that's not typical Big Ben.
So Martavis Bryant, what was the snap count last week? We looked at this yesterday.
Bryant over 80% of snaps, which is fantastic. He is, if you give Martavis Bryant over 80% of the snaps, get Big Ben a little bit healthier, of course, he's going to go off.
Yeah, I think Martavis has the potential for one of those huge weeks just based on the snap count. He does so much with so little historically in his career, and if you give him some more opportunities, it's not like the Raiders are very good against the pass.
No, not statistically.
Second to the worst in the league. So I think this game is a high-scoring game.
Yeah, well, you got two teams that are both really good against the run so far this year, and when that happens and both teams are vulnerable through the air and both teams have a good quarterback, it's a recipe for a shootout.
Now, even though the Raiders are good against the run, I'm still all in on D'Angelo Williams. I think he can go in and be 80% of Le'Veon Bell. And with Le'Veon Bell, if it's a good rushing defense, I don't care, because you get so much production through ground and through air. By the end of the day, you have a good fantasy game.
Well, they're not going to be stacking the box against a team with the amount of weapons in the passing game. Yeah. So yeah.
And then what do we say? Heath Miller.
I like Heath Miller this week.
The forecast for him changes with Big Ben.
And Le'Veon.
Le'Veon Bell.
Le'Veon.
That's his insurance twin.
Levin?
Le'Veon.
Le'Veon. Oh.
They were separated at
birth. We'll have time to film some.
And Le'Veon Bell was parent trapped away to France.
Yeah. Yeah. Classic American tale.
I don't know what my point was.
I think we were talking about Heath Miller.
Heath Miller, with Le'Veon Bell out, has seen an uptick of targets the first 2 weeks, last week. So Heath Miller is back in the tight end possibilities.
Who do you want, Cooper or Crabtree?
Cooper. I looked at this yesterday. It's Cooper.
Yeah, it's close, but I think Cooper is the more boom factor.
Who do you want, Cooper or Martavis Bryant?
Give me Martavis.
Man, I think I would still take Cooper.
Okay.
That's tough, man. I want in on this Raiders Steelers game for sure.
All right, we got to move on. We got to go to the Giants at the Buccaneers. Let me ask you this: would you start Jameis Winston over Matt Ryan?
No.
Andrew Luck this week.
I have him one spot below Luck.
I have Winston one spot above Luck. So
Luck plays Denver. So just people.
I would.
Marcus Mariota.
I'd close my eyes and when I click
Winston
the
or Mariota.
Winston.
Winston or Cousins.
Winston.
Cousins.
Okay.
We're kind of opposites here.
Yeah, I don't like you very much today.
Do we think that Duck... Now, keep in mind, the Giants just gave up 7 touchdown passes to a quarterback, which is why I bring it up, because Winston might be a streamable option. He hasn't thrown an interception, I believe, in 3 or 4 weeks. Eli Manning is a must start.
Yes, absolutely.
This game is in Tampa. They're playing a lot better. I like this game for Mike Evans quite a bit. Evans, you know, you match him up against a team that gave up 7 touchdowns through the air, and I think, you know, if somebody's going to have success in the passing game, it's going to be Evans. We know that. What about Doug Martin? Bounce back week for him?
I would think so. More, I think he'll have a better week than last week. But the
Giants
like
are bottom
like you're
half.
Saying. They're right and kind of in the middle on the run defense. But like we just said on the last game, their passing defense is so bad that teams just they choose to pass on the Giants, and you don't have to run on them because you can pass so well. I think Doug Martin will still get production, but I don't expect a kind of those huge week when he was rolling those the 3 weeks where he just monster games after monster game, multi touchdown games. I'm not expecting that this week.
Well, that's where for this game the guy that's interesting to me, and I've been kind of toying around with how high I think is Sims, because you don't have weapons in the passing game, and you've got a really vulnerable team through the air, and Sims has been a running back used in the passing game a lot.
Sims or Spiller?
Hmm.
Oh, man, that is dead tough. I'm gonna take Sims.
I would go Sims.
Sims or Chris Thompson? I guess you say Sims. Yeah. One other question I had for this game. I don't think we're starting any tight ends based on their situation right now. How do you guys treat Shane Vereen and his production levels right now? Because, you know, last week, another big game, 8 catches, scores a touchdown, doesn't get the ball between the tackles. Very hard to predict his workload. Maybe he's in that same category with the Spiller and the Sims and the Thompson and the passing down middling back. But, I mean, how do you feel about him from a fantasy perspective?
If you have to, you know, if you're short, this is a heavy bye week. If you're looking for a guy that can put up points this week, Vereen is absolutely a guy that can do that. The difference that I see between Vereen and the Sims, Spillers, Thompson is that those guys all have a floor that isn't zero.
Right.
And we've seen this year where Vereen just, he either can have a great game and then the next one come out and just not even be used, with Orleans Darkwa possibly being back, it just muddies the water more. So Vereen is, he's able to be flexed, but just know that you've got a higher ceiling, a much lower floor.
Yeah. Vereen has a clear pattern going on of boom, bad, bad. Boom, bad, bad.
Boom, bad, bad, bad. Boom, boom.
We'd do it together, though.
And he boomed last week, so I'm calling 2 bad weeks for Shane Vereen.
So that's your confidence level.
That's how I play roulette.
All right, guys. The Falcons head into San Francisco, and Goldilocks Gabbert gets the start. Now, let me say this. I'm surprised. I know it's a home game for San Francisco. I'm surprised the line's only 7.
Me too.
And I suppose this has to do with the Falcons have not played well. They just lost at home to Tampa. So what's wrong? What are you looking at me for?
Oh, I almost vomited because I thought.
I already did my start.
You did that.
That was the St. Louis Minnesota game.
Oh, okay, good. I thought you were gonna do an almost upset, and I was gonna be like,
I will. If I had to bet on the game,
poop my pants.
I would take the 49ers plus 7.
No way.
Yes, I would.
All right.
You want to water bet it?
Yes.
Water bet.
I bet you guys are gonna go to wheelofwater.com.
Ooh,
grab that free app.
Yes, nice. Yes, with a frog in her throat. Goldilocks Gabbert gets the start. The game's in San Francisco.
Yeah.
The offense for Atlanta has been struggling. They haven't scored enough points. There's been red zone turnovers. Matt Ryan is not somebody I'm super confident in starting right now. I would start him in this game, but I wouldn't feel great about it because he just hasn't given me any of those. Someone was asking me earlier, you know, they said, I need a lot of points. Eli or Matt Ryan?
Yeah, it's definitely Eli.
It's not been Matt Ryan this year.
Yeah, it's Eli.
You know, Devonta Freeman doesn't need to score to give you a great week as an RB1 anymore. He hasn't scored in 2 weeks straight. He still put up like 18 in our league format, half point PPR. So we're confident in Freeman. The report out of San Francisco for the running backs is what? A three-headed monster in San Francisco. And it's hard to call it a monster.
I was just going to say. It's like a three-headed puppy.
Right. The three-headed puppy offense. We got what? Pierre Thomas, Gaskins.
Actually, I think a three-legged.
Shane Drone.
A three-legged dog is much better.
Oh, come on now.
Well, because you can't run fast if you're a three-legged
dog. I think a three-legged dog is accurate.
In the arms of an angel. That's all I can think about.
McLaughlin?
Yeah.
Okay, so we're starting Julio. We don't worry about that. What's the report on Bolden? Is he back?
He's still, I believe, being held completely out of practice. I'm not sure if he was limited today, but I think he missed practice yesterday. And there's Bolden's another one of those tough Eric Decker type guys where, you know, he plays injured. But I think there's a legitimate chance he doesn't play again this week.
So do you start Torrey Smith with the new quarterback?
Nope.
Do you think that Gabbert will see Torrey Smith if he's completely uncovered on the side of the field at the goal line? 50-50 shot.
Yeah.
That's the only place they're going to get.
Blaine Gabbert might have those flowing locks in his face. Does Blaine Gabbert still have his long hair?
I don't think so.
I sure hope he does.
He does not. I don't think he does.
Well, that ruins everything, Blaine Gabbert.
Maybe you can grow it out.
You've gone from bad to worse.
It might help his passing. The problem is the Falcons use
he's reverse Samson. They
use the most, he just looks like a normal upstanding backup quarterback now.
I like Torrey Smith. I think Torrey Smith gets better with Gabbert than he was with Kaepernick. However, in this matchup against the cover three, the whole point of Torrey Smith of those long bombs isn't going to happen. So I would steer completely clear.
You guys want to know a hot tip, fantasy tip?
Yeah.
Don't ever
a hot wheel of water tip.
Oh, a hot.
Don't make a bet about the 49ers keeping a game close before you run through who's playing in the game.
Yeah.
Because now that I've walked back through who's playing in the game, I don't know who can make a play.
Vernon Davis? No. Oh, no. He's gone. He's gone. Anquan Boldin? He's half dead.
Kendall Gaskins? Hyde.
Okay. Yeah, I'm going to lose that bet.
It's Pierre Thomas time.
All right. This is kind of an interesting one. The Broncos go into Indianapolis.
Oh, real quick. If you've got the Atlanta defense on your waivers, play them. Okay. Go on.
Broncos go into Indianapolis. It's kind of interesting because Peyton could break the yards record in this game going back to Indianapolis, which is just would be incredible. So give me the highlights fantasy-wise. The Broncos are a defense above all others right now. So do you start anybody from Indianapolis with any type of confidence whatsoever?
The only guy I would start would be Gore.
Yep, Frank Gore, and that's it.
And so we're benching Luck for nearly everybody?
Not everybody, but there are a good amount of quarterbacks I'd rather
play. You got to start an Indianapolis wide receiver that's not T.Y. Hilton because he's out and his name is?
Moncrief.
Okay.
I might.
What about Fleener?
Yeah, Fleener's might be an okay option.
Stream the Fleen?
I would rather go Allen just for the hope of a touchdown.
How about all those owners that spent money on the waiver wire for Vernon Davis this week?
Ridiculous.
Yeah, good luck. It's going to take some time.
Okay.
For him to really get assimilated.
And do we expect some bounce back from Emmanuel Sanders after struggling last week?
I would think so. The Colts defense has been pretty rough. So I look for Thomas and Sanders to have big games.
Anything else stand out from this game that we need to cover?
Not really. This one's pretty cut and dry.
Eagles go into Dallas. Dallas is in a tailspin. This is a divisional matchup. It is the much anticipated Bradford Castle square off.
Eagles are coming off of a bye. They've had an extra week to prepare.
I've actually read something about why the offense has gotten better because they're playing both Ertz and Celek at the same time because teams just knew if Celek is out, they're going to run. If Ertz is out, they're going to pass. So they've just started throwing them
Genius.
Both out. Hey, it works. It's worked. The Philadelphia offense has been better.
Yeah, I really like both running back starts in this game. McFadden and Murray, I think, will both have pretty good games. I like Murray a lot more, but McFadden, just from a quantity standpoint, do you agree?
Oh, yeah. I love both of them. I think both of them finished top 12.
What do we think about Dez Bryant? Game two.
Yeah. Still Matt Castle.
Still Matt Castle problem? I think he is going to get force-fed a little bit. I put him in the wide receiver two range myself. What do you guys think?
Yeah. I think low end two is fine because of the sheer amount of targets and volume, and he can break a tackle, but I'm not expecting anything great, and I start a lot of guys over him.
What is your kind of fantasy thoughts on Jason Witten right now? Because it's not been great.
Yeah,
I think it's Witten and C. Nah,
I didn't even get it. It was so bad.
Yeah,
nice.
It was almost like a Murray runs through it.
I got a cool meme out of that.
That's true. I would wait and see. I'm not too confident starting Witten right now.
Would you start Witten or Ertz? The two tight ends in this game.
I'd go with Ertz.
Yeah, I agree.
You think Ertz is going to score a touchdown this year?
You know, with the amount of opportunities,
it's kind of incredible.
Bradford just needs to luck into a good throw, and he'll score one.
All right, let's move on to the Bears at the Chargers, our last matchup we want to go over, the Monday night game. Phillip Rivers has been on a tear, regardless of winning or losing. What?
No, it's just funny to think he's been so good, even though he's also really –
Two and six is a team.
You watch him last game. He was terrible. And then he gets great fantasy production.
That's all we care about.
How much of an impact does Keenan Allen going out have on him?
Yeah, you got to think it's a pretty decent chunk out of the game plan. However, I'm pretty confident that Stevie Johnson can give you a good bit of what Keenan Allen had been doing. I think he slides into that possession role. He'll get the shallow targets. He'll get the higher volume of targets. I think Malcolm Floyd, maybe he gets a slight bump Would you give him a slight bump?
Oh yeah. Yeah, yeah. I'm very fine flexing Floyd this week.
I think he's
fine flexing Floyd.
He still does what Floyd does though.
Flexing Floyd is fine.
I like the alliteration.
Yeah, it's fine. It's
very
fabulous.
Very poetic. But I like Stevie Johnson a lot this week because I liked Keenan Allen.
Yep.
A lot. I was going to like Keenan Allen a lot this week against the Bears.
Honestly, this seems like a matchup, one of those where I want the pieces on both sides of the ball because I don't think there's going to be a lot of defense here. And so if you ask me, who do I sit in this game? That is a normal startable player. There's literally no one. I want Bennett's my start of the week. I would play Cutler. I would play Rivers. Obviously, Alshon. Langford's your start of the week. You've got Stevie Johnson gets a bump up. So everybody that's playing, Antonio Gates, I think, gets a bump up if he's playing.
This player got 18 carries and 5 catches last week.
Melvin Gordon.
Melvin Gordon.
Yeah, so I think that's the kind of the biggest question of this game is Gordon versus Woodhead. What are you doing?
In a bye week situation, I'm okay flexing Gordon out there. I think he's got a baseline. I think they're using him. He can't fumble. Don't go fumbling. And honestly, I wanted to mention that. That is the risk with a Langford or anybody like that that's brand new. It's the fact that if Langford came out, just hypothetically, and he fumbled on the first drive, it's probably a timeshare the rest of the game. There's a good chance. John Fox is at the helm.
Yeah.
And so he'll risk anything. By the way, did you hear the report?
I say Matt Forte is day-to-day, fellas.
Oh, I believe his words were like, what did he say? Literally day-to-day or something like that? Like he's sincerely day-to-day.
Yes, he's day-to-day.
All players are day-to-day.
Alshon Jeffrey was day-to-day, and Kevin White, who's still on the inactive roster.
Day-to-day.
He's day-to-day.
Yeah, so this should be a fantasy. There's nobody we're sitting, really. The only question I would say is, like, put these guys in order. Marquise Wilson, Stevie Johnson, and Malcolm Floyd.
It would go Stevie, then I'll take...
I'd go Stevie, Floyd, and then...
Yeah, I think the other
That's
two,
what I would do, too.
The two are close for me, but I'd probably lean Floyd.
All right, it's time to take a break and talk about some daily fantasy football with our good friend Chris Meaney of the Fantasy Sports Network.
The Daily Dose.
The fantasy footballers are joined once again by our bestest friend from the Great White North, Chris Meaney from the Fantasy Sports Network. He's here to talk some DFS strategies. How are you doing this fine day?
I feel the same about you guys. You guys are my besties as well.
That's awesome.
Someday we'll be able to hug with real arms. And not yes. Just digital arms.
We're hoping to get you guys up here in the Fantasy Sports Network studios, hopefully pretty soon.
Oh, we would love it. We'll do a show up there.
Sure, wait for it to get nice and cold up there. Wait for it to get nice and chilly.
It's just getting nice where we live.
You realize we do not own jackets.
Yeah, that's the thing. We'll wait till it's like minus 25 and snowing, and we'll make sure you guys get up here.
When they're giving plane tickets away.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, let's get into the daily talk. So let's start at the top of the board. The big budget guys, the big budget quarterbacks. Are you buying a Tom Brady and Aaron Rodgers? What are you doing this week, Chris?
I'm certainly going to have Tom Brady in one of my lineups. I mean, this guy is just, I feel like he's just going to crush Washington this weekend. So I'm going to have Tom Brady. Obviously, you're going to have to get some values in there if you're going to do Tom Brady. Last week I was off Freeman and it wasn't really a Freeman week, but he was actually okay. He just got a couple fumbles and didn't find the end zone. And I think that might be his floor. I mean, the whole at least 10 double digit points without getting the touchdown. So I think I'm back on Freeman 8-9 against San Francisco. I'm certainly going to have to pay for Tom Brady though. And at $9,500, it's a lot of money. But I do like him. And then again, I mean, you're kind of silly if you don't go Odell Beckham Jr. again in at least one of your lineups. It's a nice matchup, the Giants against Tampa Bay. We saw last week, wow, Pittsburgh, or not. I was big on Pittsburgh Cincy. I thought that would be a high-scoring game, but it was the Saints and the Giants. So, I'd like to pay for Odell Beckham Jr., and Antonio Brown still at 8-7 seems like a steal. Those are the top guys that I'd be willing to pay for.
Okay, let's get into the middle-tier guys. And guys who we're used to performing, like, let's say an Eddie Lacy. What are your thoughts on a guy like him in a tougher matchup?
Yeah, I have to see it. I have to see it from Eddie Lacy. I mean, I just haven't seen it yet. He's averaging 8 FanDuel points per game. It's not great. It's not somebody that I trust, certainly not in a 50-50 or a cash game. In a tournament play, it could be okay. But again, I really have to see it from these guys first. I'd rather play McFadden 6-5 against Philadelphia. I'd rather play Langford 6-4 against San Diego. San Diego struggled against the run. I don't think Langford's all that great, but I do expect him to get about 20 touches. Again, with New England, I think it's going to be a Blunt game. 6-4 is okay, but again, you just don't know with Blunt. And Andrews is supposed to be the guy for Tennessee now. I don't have much stock and faith in him either. I just feel like they're going to be down in this game. They're going to have troubles running the ball. But, I mean, D'Angelo Williams at 6'5", it seems like a steal. I know you guys are big on him, too, because I got a couple of questions about D'Angelo Williams and somebody else.
6'5" is amazing.
Yeah, 6'5" is a steal. It's unbelievable, yeah. And I think at the first two games of the year without Le'Veon Bell, he was great. And he still had 100 yards last week. I mean, and he didn't play the full game. So I do like D'Angelo Williams at 6'5". I think it's a steal. I'm going big on Oakland this week. I just love the Raiders. I like Derek Carr. I keep talking about Crabtree at 5'8". His price has not changed. He's still 5'8", $5,800. 2 touchdowns last 2 games. He's got at least 50 yards in 4 straight games. He's got 8 targets in every single game but one, where he got the ankle injury and he was bummed out a little bit. So I love Carr. I love Crabtree. I just think that people should continue to roll these guys. And even Amari Cooper is nice as well at 7'3".
D'Angelo Williams for DFS reminds me greatly of last year, and it was pretty close to about this time when Giovanni Bernard went down and Jeremy Hill arrived on the
scene. Took over.
And he was just the DFS monster for mega cheap for weeks before his price eventually went up. All right, let's talk some value, guys. The bums at the bottom. Nobody wants this trash except the sifter of the trash who finds the diamonds in the rough. Chris Meaney, who do we got at the bottom this week, my man?
Well, this is the bottom of the bottom. It's Justin Hardy. If Hankerson doesn't play, I actually think Hardy could be okay. Listen, you know, they threw the ball 45 times, Ryan, and Roddy White only had 3 targets. So that's the bottom of the barrel that I would go with Justin Hardy. There's a couple other guys I like more than him. Malcolm Floyd I like a lot against Chicago 6-1. I like Brendan LaFell. Again, I think that the Patriots are going to be able to have their way with Washington. So if you want to get a piece of that offense, 5-2 is fairly cheap for Brendan LaFell. And I know we didn't touch on Breeze at all, and I know a lot of people may be on him because of that big week, but he has an amazing schedule coming up, and I think people should take notice of that. You got Tennessee, Washington, Houston, then Carolina, Tampa, Detroit, Jacksonville, Atlanta to finish. His favorite target seems to be Watson. Ben Watson has 27 targets, 23 catches, over 300 yards, and 2 scores over the last 3 weeks. It seems pretty good. We all thought Jeremy Hill. I certainly thought, or not Jeremy, Josh Hill was going to be the guy, the sleeper guy, but it seems like Watson is taking everything that Jimmy Graham had last year.
And so a defense, let's talk defenses this time. Who do you like this week that we can get a little bit cheaper?
Yeah, defense, it's funny. I always kind of say I'm going to get the cheapest defense, but the past couple weeks with the guys that have been winning the millionaire, they had 20 points from their defense and 20 from their kicker. I like the Eagles defense. I think that they make things happen. They're averaging 10 FanDuel points per game, which out of all the other defenses going this week, there's only 3 of them that average double-digit points. And you got, obviously, the Broncos up at the top, and then you got the Rams in there. Philadelphia against Dallas, a team that is obviously having issues getting touchdowns. Castle does not look good at all. So I like that defense to make things happen, you know, get a couple picks. They're opportunistic, and they do get some picks. As much as, you know, a lot of people like to pick on that secondary, they kind of get things happen that way. So the other defense is Carolina, that's averaging 10 points, and I'm not playing them against Aaron Rodgers, who could only get 70 yards last week. I got 2 defenses here if you want some. Pat Mayo joining me right
now. Yeah, what up, Mayo?
What's happening, guys?
You guys are
overlooking the awesome defenses of the AFC East. The Bills and that pass rush against the Dolphins, like, that's not fine to the Dolphins being back. The Bills are going to be fine. And the Jets against Jacksonville. Come on now. Jacksonville bleeds points to defenses. No one's taking these two. They're great defenses.
How do you
what
not bring
Atlanta
up Atlanta?
Fran, no, that's a trap.
No, that's a trap.
That's a trap.
Blaine Gabbert's going to be okay.
Yeah, I'll be
what?
Fine.
Blaine Gabbert.
Where are the points coming from?
We need to do a water bet with you, Mayo, and we'll throw the ice on you when we get out there.
Oh, that's not going to hurt. Like, ice on ice is not a problem. So Sneak appearance by Pat Mayo. Guerrilla warfare fantasy advice. We love it. So thanks, guys. Thank you so much. We'll check in with you next week.
All right, guys. Good luck this weekend.
All right. More good stuff from Chris Meaney and the special guest, Pat Mayo, dropping in. We got to get him on the show again.
Yeah, we do.
Because he's like a espresso yeah. to the show. He yeah. just livens it up.
I was going to go with a more narcotic-like substance.
Yeah, let's
for
make
Pat
sure.
Mayo.
Yeah, we'll make sure to tweet that out to him. Let him know what we think. Let's go ahead and take a couple minutes, get into the listener mailbag before we close out this Friday show.
Mailbag.
Mailbag.
Yeah.
All right. You know the drill. If you want to ask us a question, go to the website, thefantasyfootballers.com. Click on the submit a question button, and ba boom, you send us your question.
Ba 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 boom.
George in Miami. I'm in second, and I'm playing against the first place team this week in a nice matchup.
Okay.
Running backs are Deion Lewis, Lamar Miller, and D'Angelo Williams, and you got to start two of them.
Half point PPR. Ooh, half point PPR makes it interesting.
Yeah, I think D'Angelo I want in there. And I think I'm going to go Lamar Miller over Deion Lewis. What do you guys think?
I'm going to go Lewis.
Lewis Williams for me.
Yeah, me too.
Okay.
Lucas in São Paulo, Brazil. I feel like we're getting a São Paulo, Brazil question in every mailbag section.
Bonjour.
It might be Lucas every time. hey, guys. Should I start Allen Robinson or stay in the flames with Stefon Diggs?
Stefon Diggs. I think Allen Robinson's going to be on Revis Island this week, and I don't like him.
Yeah. I agree completely.
I think
I don't love Diggs' matchup this week, though.
Me too.
I just, the Rams, they're getting it done.
Yeah.
Okay, let me ask you this. Andy from Phoenix has a question.
Andy from across the table.
Yes, Andy from across the table. Related somewhat. I've got two defenses that I can't decide who to play. Rams in Minnesota, who the Rams have been on fire. The Jets at home against Jacksonville. Jacksonville reminds me a little too much of the way Oakland can, they have weapons. Jets were -8 in our league last week. Who would you play in that? Because I've gone back and forth. I've literally moved them in and out of my lineup.
I know who I would play. I would play the Jets. They're a ball-hawking team. They're at home. Their pride has been hurt from last week. And I think they're going to come out and smash them in the mouth.
I would also go with the Jets. I know the Rams, I agree with you. They've been on fire, and I expect them to continue. However, Minnesota is at home. They have a pretty strong offensive line up there in Minnesota, and you still have the Adrian Peterson factor, and Diggs is really coming on. There's just a higher chance that Minnesota at home can put up some points.
Yeah. Ryan in Holland Patton, New York. Should I start Martellus Bennett or Jordan Reed?
Ooh, I like that one. Martellus Bennett is my start of the week. I really like him, but I'm not sure I like him more than Jordan Reed.
You sure do.
Then I'm going Martellus Bennett.
I'm going to take Reed.
Rule 86.
I love that. I can't believe it. Rule 86 in the fantasy handbook matched his jersey number. That was really funny yesterday.
So Rule 86, for those who are not in the know, is if Jordan Reed is playing, he is in your lineup.
Yeah, so... All right, that's it for today's show. I want to remind everybody to check out jointhefoot.com. Visit our fantasy football community. Come talk to us. We do this show for you, for the listeners. That's why we're here. And, man, there were some really, really funny, really great iTunes reviews that came in over the last 24 hours, including one that simply said, the title of the review, hold on.
Oh!
Reviewasaurus Rex.
All right, the title of the review was Mike's Laugh.
Okay, I like this already.
Mike's Laugh.
I like it.
And it said, Mike has a contagious laugh, which is why I listen to the podcast every day. Also, I'm winning in all of my leagues. Thanks, guys. So, one part laughter.
A little known fact, because I don't publicize it very much, but I have an additional podcast. It's just 5 minutes of me laughing.
Is it?
Yeah.
Does it have your guitar ballad in the background?
No, this is just unadulterated Mike laughter for 5 minutes on loop.
I'm not subscribing to that one.
Yeah.
So, hey, thanks for listening today.
My mom does.
We'll be back after week 9. And check out the Wheel of Water app, wheelofwater.com.
Wheel of
water.
Goodbye.
Thank you for listening to another edition of the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Don't forget to visit us on the web at www.thefantasyfootballers.com and follow us on Twitter at the FF Ballers.
Sounds like you need a little bit more slack on your table there. That's for sure what it was. Yeah, because it's shortened.
Sure. I want to make sure that we are causing farts, no matter what.
I didn't.